Right. The first thing we need to do is grab some Bibles. So at the end of the pews, you will find, sorry, the end of the rows of chairs, you'll find additional Bibles, and there's more over there as well, should you need them. We're going to be reading from the book of Luke. So we're going to need to find page 1048 in the Bibles, and we'll need the Bibles afterwards as well as Matt comes to unpack the scripture for us. I'll just give us a few more moments to find the page. And we're reading from Luke chapter 14. That's on the left-hand side on the right column. Okay, so we're reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14, verses 25 to 38. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? But if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear."
Thanks, Tom. Morning, everyone. Great to be with you this morning. Younger youth are just heading out now to meet Ross and the team. So as they head out, let me also say welcome if you're watching from home online. As James said, we're listening to Jesus for the first half of term, and we're in Luke's Gospel, some wonderful parables we're going to be looking at, but we begin this morning with this passage on the cost of discipleship. So as always, we're going to pray as we begin, and we're going to ask God for his help as we come to his word. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that you are the God who speaks. But we recognize as we gather together this morning that we struggle on our own to listen. So we ask now for that work of your Spirit in our hearts, that we might hear your voice and know how to respond in repentance and faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I don't know about you, but I don't like it when someone offers me a deal under false pretenses. I don't like being ripped off. The budget airline offering low rates until several clicks later, when you've entered all your details, you discover that there's a surcharge for any passenger who wishes to board the aircraft wearing clothes, or that sort of thing. Or the insurance company, I was looking for a quote the other day, that offers you a really competitive premium. And if you're anything like me, you think, I can save a few quid on last year, only to discover a little bit later on that you're hit by a whole raft of extras. It's one of those lessons in life, isn't it? If you don't check the small print, it will come back to bite you. That's why I love Ernest Shackleton. This is a biography Ranulph Fiennes published just last year. My dad gave it to one of the children. I suspect I will end up reading it as well. Shackleton, of course, famous for the race to the pole, and his expeditions across Antarctica, most famously the Endurance Expedition 1914, that's the one in the BBC drama, where famously, as the story goes, he placed the following advert: "Men wanted for hazardous journey, small wages, bitter cold, long months of complete darkness, constant danger, safe return doubtful, honor and recognition in case of success. Well, there's no small print to worry about there, is there? Just tells it like it is up front. And the wonderful thing about Jesus Christ is he does the same. There's no small print with Jesus. Three times in our passage this morning, he spells it out. Just look with me at verse 26. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Verse 27. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Then once more, further down, verse 33. Any of you who does not give up everything cannot be my disciple. And as you listen to that, notice who Jesus is speaking to here. Just look at verse 25. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus. He isn't speaking just to the inner circle. He's talking to the crowds. If anyone, he says. So this passage isn't just for the elite level Christian. You know, as if there's kind of the ordinary rank and file Christian, you know, who come, you come when you can, that sort of thing. But then there are the sort of special forces Christians who are the super keen ones, and that's who Jesus is talking to here. No, he's talking to anyone who is even thinking about following him. It may be that you haven't yet got started personally as a follower of Jesus. Perhaps you were with us over Christmas, you heard about Jesus, and you're back because you want to know more. If that is you, it is great that you're here. Because Jesus' teaching in this passage is not just for the converted, it is for anyone. Jesus wants anyone who is contemplating a relationship with him to know what that involves. You see, he loves you too much to sugarcoat the realities of the Christian life for the sake of numbers. I have to confess, as a church leader, if I had large crowds following me, then I would be thinking, this is great. And I'd be lining people up for baptism, I'd put a giving form in their hands, and all the time I'd be thinking, I'll get to the difficult parts of discipleship later on. You know, when they're up and running and I've got them on board. But Jesus doesn't do that because he loves you. So whether you've been a Christian for decades this morning or you think maybe you're at the point where you want to get started with him, we're going to listen to Jesus as he explains here what being a disciple is all about. And the first thing Jesus says is, consider the shape of discipleship. Disciple literally means learner or student. And Jesus is very clear in these opening verses about what he requires of his students. In the first century, a rabbi typically had a group of disciples who would follow him in order to learn from him. And if you were to sort of commit to that particular school, that was a big thing. So if you were going to follow Rabbi Forward or Rabbi Clark or Rabbi Marion Jones or, you know, I don't know how many Welsh rabbis you can have, but if you were going to do that, that was a big commitment. But no rabbi would ever have asked for the kind of commitment that Jesus asks for here. You see, to be a disciple of Jesus means putting him even above your own family. Which straight away brings us to the word hate in verse 26. And there's an edge to that, isn't there? We feel it, don't we? So what does Jesus mean? Well, he isn't asking you to dishonor your parents. That would go against the fifth commandment. He isn't asking you to despise your partner or your children or your siblings. That would contradict his teaching from earlier in Luke on love your neighbor. It would go against the New Testament's teaching for husbands and wives and parents. So we need to think carefully about how this word hate is being used. And what we find when we examine the scriptures is that it literally means to love less. It's a Hebrew expression for preference. That's where it comes from. So if you're asking me to choose, then I love raspberry jam and I hate apricot jam. It's an expression of preference. So, for example, in Genesis 29, we're told in verse 30 that Jacob's love for Rachel was greater than his love for Leah. And in the very next verse, we're told Leah was not loved, or literally, she was hated. It's an expression of preference. Jacob preferred Rachel. Jesus isn't saying here, don't love your family, don't be committed to your family. The Bible's clear that family is good and necessary and foundational. But it is not ultimate. And that is the bit that goes against our culture, which holds family up so often as the number one thing, and everything else sits underneath it. If we want to follow Jesus, he demands nothing less than our ultimate allegiance. And of course, that is going to have implications. Now, obviously, COVID means some are having to stay away at the moment, which of course we completely understand. But just park COVID for a moment and think about the implications. It's going to have implications for our time. For some of us, just being here on a Sunday, that'll put you at odds with your family. It may have been hard to walk out of the house this morning. Can I say, if that's you, you are more of an encouragement to the rest of us than you might realize. It'll have implications for our choices about work or career or retirement. It'll shape our attitude to money, to hospitality, what we do with our homes, our possessions. It'll shape what we do with our sexuality, who we go out with, who we marry, if we marry. And if that all feels a little bit full on, that's because it is. But when we remember who Jesus is, it does make sense. And we were reminded over Christmas in John 1 that Jesus is the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. In Colossians 1, he's the firstborn over all creation. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. No wonder he demands our complete allegiance above all other things. He's the God of the universe. Jesus didn't come as a life coach to help us to be a better version of ourselves in 2022. Nor did he come as a taskmaster, and all he really wants to do is give you more stuff you've got to do in the year ahead, and already you're sinking under the weight of it. No, he came as our Lord and Savior, that we might worship him with everything we have. Now, where does that take us? Well, putting Jesus first will mean carrying your cross. This is verse 27. And remember, Jesus is traveling here to Jerusalem. Go back to chapter 9, verse 51 in Luke, key moment in the book. And Luke records, as the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem, where, of course, he knows he will literally carry his cross to his death, so that he can save his people, people like us, from their sins. To carry your cross is to embrace the shame that comes from the world when we surrender our lives to Jesus. Now, we trivialize it, of course, with that little phrase, well, we all have our crosses to bear, by which I usually mean backache or, you know, having to look after Aunt Ethel over Christmas or whatever it is. And we render it nothing. But Jesus is talking here about the shame that comes when we pledge our allegiance to him ahead of everything else. J.C. Ryle, one of my heroes, Bishop of Liverpool in the 18th century, great man of God, said that to be a Christian, it will cost a man the favor of the world. Maybe you're experiencing that at the moment with your neighbor or your colleagues. It's not that they're openly hostile, although they might be. It's just that you don't fit in quite as easily as everyone else does. Can I say, if you are, that is normal. Jesus can see that you love him, and you are more of an encouragement to the rest of us than you realize. But it's no wonder, is it, that on the way to Jerusalem, the crowds began to thin out as people turned away, until as he went to the cross, there was hardly anyone left. So consider then the shape of discipleship. Then second, Jesus says, count the cost of discipleship. Now, of course, it's only through the cross that we qualify, as it were, for heaven. So we mustn't lose sight of God's grace here. It is Jesus who pays the price for our sin. He is the only way we get in. But that doesn't mean it won't cost us to follow him. Which is why Jesus uses these two little illustrations, which I think are there to kind of stop us from sort of jumping into discipleship without first grasping what's involved. And the first one comes straight from the building site. Look with me at verse 28. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, "This fellow began to build and was not able to finish." Just around the corner from where we used to live in London, somebody bought a wreck of a house a few years ago and began doing it up. Big project into the loft, you know, out across the back, major refurb. And to begin with, it looked very impressive. The builders moved fast. You could see it all taking shape. Until one day, all of a sudden, everything ground to a halt and work stopped without any warning, not a builder in sight. And then rumors began to circulate. Issues with funding, perhaps. Had the money run out? Some were saying that was what had happened. Problems with planning? Something in the family? Had the owner run into trouble? And the scaffolding stayed up, but the sheeting just blew about in the breeze. And month after month, the house stood there, half finished, as a reminder of what happens when you start something that you cannot complete. If we want to follow Jesus, we need to know what it is we're getting into. It'd be foolish to say yes to Jesus without first counting the cost and owning the commitment that he asks for. Then from the building site, Jesus goes to the battlefield. Look with me at verse 31. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? And at first glance, it looks pretty much like just Jesus is saying same again. But where that first illustration was about the cost of following Jesus, this second one is actually about the cost of not following Jesus. If you look closely, there are two kings here. And one of them does his sums. And he realizes that he cannot stand against the other. Indeed, it would be foolish even to try. So this is about recognizing authority and knowing when to submit. When you know you're in a battle you cannot win, your only option is to ask for terms of peace. I try and teach this to my children all the time. Mixed results. What are the terms of peace here? Surrender to Jesus Christ as Lord. See, the cost of not following Jesus is that you live your life as his enemy. You live your life at war with the God who made you. Now, of course, the non-Christian listens to this. He counts the cost and he just thinks, how could I possibly follow Jesus? The cost is way too high. I can't do that. The Christian listens to this and says, how could I not? He gave everything for me. He paid for my life with his blood. What could be more precious than a life spent following Jesus as my Savior, my Lord, and my friend? Count the cost of discipleship before you get started. Because if we don't, we're going to struggle to stay the course. And that brings us to our final point. Where Jesus says, complete the course of discipleship. He's just been talking about the need to submit to the one who is greater, and that, we discover, means giving up everything. Look with me at verse 33, this third statement that Jesus makes. In the same way, he says, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. And literally, Jesus says here, it means renouncing all things. He's talking about letting go of all our earthly attachments, our material possessions, our worldly pleasures. But more than that, our self-righteousness, our pride, our personal autonomy, our life plan, our agenda. You've got to give all of it up if you want to follow Jesus. And back at the beginning of Luke, that, of course, is what the first disciples did. The fishermen, Simon, James, and John, Luke chapter 5, left everything and followed him. Levi, the tax collector, a little bit later, left everything and followed him. The rich ruler in chapter 18 was told, sell everything you have and give it to the poor, then come follow me. Each time, the same message. You've got to give up everything if you want to be my disciple. You feel the weight of it, don't you? Dietrich Bonhoeffer, writing on this about discipleship, said, the first suffering which every Christian must experience is the call to abandon the attachments of this world. He said, it is that dying of the old man which is the result of his encounter with Christ. As we embark upon discipleship, we surrender ourselves to Christ in union with his death. When Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. Can I ask you this morning, have you had that personal encounter with Jesus Christ? Wonderfully, here at St. James, so many of us have. And we've heard the call to abandon the attachments of this world. None of us finds it easy. And yet I'm told that in the past few months, lots of people have given sacrificially to help with our finances. More on that next week. And I know that others are opening up your homes whenever you can to offer hospitality to people you don't actually know very well, people here in church. Or you're abandoning your leisure opportunities, which in this part of the world on a Sunday morning are many and varied and they are attractive. And yet you are letting go of those things to gather with your church family. You're a huge encouragement to the rest of us. And there's real joy to be had in it, the kind of joy Catherine was praying about earlier. But if you haven't yet surrendered to Jesus, why not do it today? It's possible, isn't it, to profess faith with great enthusiasm and a certain amount of knowledge, but without ever actually yielding to Christ. And the thing is, until we do that, to the point of renouncing all things, we won't truly know the joy of being saved. And nor will we know the joy of being useful in God's kingdom. You see, just look at the warning here that Jesus gives. Verse 33, have a look. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown out. Well, salt that is chemically pure, of course, cannot lose its saltiness. That's the kind of salt we have. But this is first century Palestine, where salt was far from pure. So all it took was a little bit of moisture, some evaporation, and then it lost all its purity. And although it looked like salt, there was actually no salt, no purity in it at all, which meant it was no good for anything. What does that look like in today's money? Well, you can have a top-of-the-range Tesla. It'd be nice to have one of those, wouldn't it? Model S, I believe. Brand new, top spec. And you can set off from Gerrard's Cross to John O'Groats, around the M25, up the M1, all good, cruising along in your brand new Tesla. You know where this is going, don't you? If the battery loses its charge for whatever reason, it doesn't matter that it's a Model S. It doesn't matter that it's brand new and shiny and you look quite good behind the wheel. It may as well be a beaten-up Fiesta with a broken clutch. Because it is useless to you. You're going nowhere. Outward appearances and good beginnings don't count for very much in the Christian life. To be a disciple is to go the distance. If you were at Prayer Central on Wednesday evening, you'll know we were praying for world mission, particularly in Europe. And amongst other things, we were praying for our mission partners, Peter and Veronica Tichy in Prague, working with the Bethel community there. They're working with men and women to help them to get free from addiction, and they're introducing them to the gospel as they do that. And Veronica asked us to pray for the men and women who've become Christians through the program, and they're getting free from addiction. And she asked us to pray that as they move on and out from the program, they would find a church to belong to. And she said this, I wrote it down. She said, please pray that these men and women will stay the course as disciples of Jesus. And it's the same for us. How awful it would be to find ourselves thrown out by God. That is how Jesus puts it here. When we could have been used by God for his kingdom. How awful it would be to get started with Jesus only to find that because we never really counted the cost, we failed to complete the course. I don't know about you, but in 2022, I want to know the joy of being used by God for his kingdom. I want us as a church family to experience the joy of being useful to God in his mission to reach the people all around us. So complete the course, says Jesus. As I finish, one last time, our old friend J.C. Ryle, he said this, there is a common worldly kind of Christianity which many have and think they have enough. A cheap Christianity which offends nobody and requires no sacrifice, which costs nothing and is worth nothing. That is not the Christianity, is it, that Jesus talks about here? But it is a version that the world is willing to tolerate, which is what makes it so attractive to you and me. Because out there, I want to be liked and I want to be accepted. But as a church, we want to listen to Jesus. And Jesus says this morning, consider the shape, count the cost, and complete the course. Now, what he doesn't tell us is exactly how to make every single decision. But he does ask us to submit every decision to him. So we've got to commit this year to opening our Bibles together with one another as brothers and sisters in church, and we've got to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us as we do that. We've got to pray it through. We've got to wrestle in our hearts with what discipleship looks like in the nitty-gritty of the choices we face day by day. We can't do that without each other. We can't do that without God and his word in the power of his Spirit. So I'm going to pray now as we close, and then we're going to pause, and we're just going to take a bit of time in the silence as an opportunity just for each one of us to do business with God this morning as we count the cost and we look at the year ahead and we think about where you need to put Jesus first, and then we'll sing. Let's pray. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Our gracious Father, we listen to your word this morning and we confess that we feel the weight of it. We feel the cost of following Jesus. And Father, we're willing to admit that for some of us, we're not sure if we can do it. And so we thank you for Jesus' honesty. We thank you for the truth with which he speaks here. And we thank you, Father, that the one who asks us to give everything up for him is the one who has already given up everything for us there at the cross. And we thank you that as Jesus asks us to put him first above all things, even our own families, he does not ask us to do that alone. Father, you give us one another in church family. And you give us your Holy Spirit to dwell within us, to help us to follow Jesus not only as our Savior, but also as our Lord. In his name we pray. Amen.